Madera 95, unlimited excitement for an entire week at the unlimited radio-controlled air races in Madera, California. Madera this year sported a full complement of race classes, which included the attractive Formula One aircraft. Formula One racers are patterned from the full-size aircraft with a lot of personal touch applied, like this unique tiger color scheme. Bill Hempel Jr. expresses his feelings about this type of race activity.
Hi, my name is Bill Hempel Jr. I'm part of the Hobby Barn Racing Team, and we're here at this year's 1995 Madera Unlimited Air Races. Back in 1991, the Hobby Barn Racing Team and myself piloted an A26 Invader and took the gold in 1991, first place. And we've been here ever since then, 1992, 3, 4, and we're trying again in 1995 to take home the gold again. And it just seems like it's getting harder each time we get here. The planes are a lot faster. In fact, our airplane that won the gold in 91 wouldn't even qualify for the bronze class this year.
A new and growing class, now in the second year of the Madera Air Races, is a small but fast biplane class, again in all sizes and unique shapes, each one representing the pilot's taste or his sponsor's logos. These aircraft will run in the 125 to 155 mile per hour range. The AT6 class runs under the limited guidelines adopted from the limited full-size Reno Air Race counterparts. This class is increasingly popular and is deemed the best entry class to get into the racing activity regardless of age. One of the youngest racers is Brian Esco, and we gave him the microphone.
I'm 15 years old. I've been flying for about 2-3 years, off and on, just during the summer mostly. I love it here at Madera. I'm really excited about being here, meeting everybody around. It's just a great experience for me. This is my first race. It's my first experience really actually with a big quarter scale airplane. Best experience I've ever had in my life. It's a great learning experience. I wish more people my age would be in it. And it's great to be out of school.
The hot rods of radio-controlled air racing, the very fast unlimited aircraft. These aircraft will run in the 135 to 200 mile plus range in the gold class. We were able to catch a few words from a 200 mile per hour racer, Dave Von Linsaway.
Hi, this is Dave Von Linsaway. I'm here at the 95 Madera Races. This is my second attempt at the Madera Races. I was here about 2 years ago trying to qualify. The airplane was a little bit slow, didn't make qualifications, and last year couldn't make the races because of preparations for the Tournament of Champions. This year, I was fortunate, coming back from Japan, I got the opportunity to fly this Lancer, powered by an A-cubed 8.8-cylinder engine. Right now, we've qualified third fastest, and overall, if you combine our two scores, we've got the fastest two times. Just very fortunate to be here with this airplane. It's doing about a little over 200 miles an hour in a straightaway, and it's hooking up very well.
Heat racing started very early in the week, and I might add, very early in the morning. The racers were up early and testing their skills against the competitors they would meet for the cash money on Sunday afternoon.
Wayne Boyles in the yellow T6 coming very close.
After 5 years of this type of racing, it was obvious that the pilots were capable of running in a tighter pack. This will make for some exciting racing for this week at Madera. Many pilots came to the race and were no strangers to the pressure of the course. For some, they had more than pressure to deal with, as they were dealt a bad hand by gravity and Murphy's Law.
Four unlimited aircraft.
Some of these crashes were not repairable. Others were more fortunate and would race this weekend, like Wayne Voiles here with a sputtering power plant. Watch as he pops only one gear down and pulls them up again for a safe belly landing.
appears to be okay. Wayne Boyle.
Some of the mishaps were just plain embarrassing, like this Mustang Strega with a steep, steep approach. This does, however, give you a chance to see the size of these hot rods as this crew member retrieves this unlimited stiletto.
Version of the Mustang. I hate it when that happens. One of the oldest T6s on the circuit.
Let's take a look now at some of the early heat races, and this limited T6 race is a good example of good racing.
Wes Daly still in that second place slot as they approach Highline 1 in 669. Pulling very hard to stay away from Tom Ruhlman in 657, moving up underneath him on the backside of the straightaway. Both aircraft just inches apart. 669 pulls it off again at pylon 3, down low on the deck in that second place slot as they approach pylon number 1. And Wes Daly, once again, pulls tightly around one to hold off 657.
The colorful Formula One aircraft were at it early in the week as well, plying their skills against each other.
John Crone in race 88, starting to reel in Don Coulter. Hopefully he has enough time left to pull it off. Don Coulter now.
Now, watch as John Crone sucks Don Coulter's Formula One into the dirt.
Crone running downhill to pick up the extra speed on this side of the straightaway. Both aircraft at pylon number 1 now at the same time. And Don Coulter, 771.
And it appears that John Crone's GR7 will need some repair work after this landing. And now, the exciting biplane class in its second year and gaining popularity.
Hammer down. And Johnny gets his tail feathers dusted. Kent McKenna in 88, the clip wing long racer, the In-N-Out Burger Special, slamming around pylon number 1, says, we're going to make this a real race. Kent McKenna heading for pylon 2 and 3 now, sponsored by Pegasus Hobbies. Right up on top of him, Ron Eisner in 667, sponsored by Discovery Wings and Classical Racing. John Eaton in 52 managed to get himself back in at number 2 slot. John Eaton, by the way, sponsored by Aerotronics, flying a scratch-built Knight Twister, powered by one of John Eaton's own J44 engines. John comes back on this side every time, giving Ron Eisner something to think
Twin
about.
Twin engine, unlimited aircraft are no strangers to Madeira, even though they arrive in small numbers due to the expense and complexity.
Drop the hammer racing.
This P-38 is an excellent example of precision racing equipment, built by Bob Walker of Robart and Dennis Crooks. Dennis is piloting this beauty, and listen to the sound of the two twin inline Husky Challenger engines. The first Madera Gold Unlimited race was won 5 years ago with an A-26 twin, so we won't count them out until the final flag drops this weekend.
The next.
This will give you an idea of the size of this great-looking P-38 of Dennis Crooks. That is Bob Walker of Robart handling the towing chores.
And really applying the pressure.
This is late day Thursday evening, and the pilots had to really watch their aircraft closely in the disappearing sunlight. Watch closely as one of these hot dogs loses orientation and the aircraft meets with disaster. Racing was done for Thursday, and all the pits were full of activity. The early evening was a good time to take a deep breath after a hectic day of heat racing. Now it was time to tweak engines, charge batteries, admire your aircraft, change props and spinners, and carve out a fuselage for some really serious modifications. The crews worked well into the evening. Tomorrow was Friday, and a full day of heat racing was ahead. Friday morning racing started early with the biplane class. Keep your eye on this week's special of Bubba Spivey's as he powers onto the race course.
And Bubba Putz Boy Spivey eats it in the dirt. Cliff Sands right on the tail.
Meanwhile, Cliff Sands in the red and black Night Twister sweeps under Ralph Braun's yellow Christian Eagle in the still air of the early morning.
Sponsored by plane known as the Night Twister. Replicas of full-size biplanes raced at Reno Air Races.
As the day wears on, the racing just got better. This heat was comprised of some real hot dogs with a big surprise from the Japanese entry. This orange and white T6 is Gary Hover in a club-sponsored entry taking an early lead. Gary is feeling some real heat from the Discovery Channel yellow entry piloted by Ron Eisner as they run pylon 2 and 3. Gary Hover in race 027 holds on to the lead as they zoom around pylon 1. Lurking in the third place spot is the Japanese entry from the Sangamido Hobby Shop in Japan, piloted by Takahashi Kimura. Watch now as Takahashi makes his move on your first and second place aircraft.
This is Ken Knowles now running pylon number 3.
Takahashi Kimura really applying the pressure and driving a tight path around the pylons. Now has Gary Hover in his sights, but Gary manages to hold him off until the finish of the race, placing him first, Takahashi Kimura second, and Ron Eisner in the Discovery Channel T6 in the third place slot.
Hey now, Gary Hover in race 27, down on the deck as he bangs around pylon number 1. And race number 3, we have no pilot information on that red and white. I believe that's the Sangamido aircraft.
Race fans were out early Friday morning to catch all of the activity. And speaking of activity, the T6 gas dock was a busy place for defueling and refueling all of the limited T6 racers before each heat.
Visibility.
The last T6 heat of the day featured 5 aircraft and displayed very tight racing.
Have a race. Let's drop the hammer. 5 of them bang around pylon 3 across the checkered flag. And boy, are they working close. Check for scratches on the wingtips later. All 5 of these aircraft beautifully matched, transposing right through each other. Black silhouettes, unless you've got those Zurich optical quartz-coated sunglasses on. Stokes stealing around the course out in front of the pack, holding off some pretty good challenges, opening up the string a little bit, taking some of the pressure off as he heads to pylon number 1.
Well, that's a wrap, as they say in showbiz, and Friday racing comes to an end. As we strolled through the pits, we were able to track down Frank McKindle from Vancouver for a few words about racing.
We get sort of down here early if we can, we get prepared. And you go around and you sort of get really spooked by all the competitors' new stuff, because it's stuff that you haven't seen. It's really tough flying down here in California when you live on Vancouver Island and you don't see the competitors' stuff. This year, when we come down here, we're running across the Herb Branson engine, we're running across all the new neat gadgets that they've done to the Aero Quadra and that kind of stuff. And we're trying to catch up as fast as we can in a couple of days that we have before heats. And boy, it's fun. It's very exciting. The crew had to work late last night. Just thinking of that, a little bit of technology gain that we weren't aware of. The slight change, the engine died on us. We ended up putting it out in the grass there. Took the gear off. The crew was up until 10 o'clock last night. And that seems to be the way racing goes. It's going all the time. Down here in Madera, it's a week of pretty intense flying from 7 o'clock in the morning until, well, not flying, but you basically start at 7 o'clock in the morning, you're finished at 5. It's really intense. You go from ecstatic joy 1 second, you die the next second as you see your airplane flame out or do something crazy. That's a super duper roller coaster. We enjoy it.
Okay, hi. My name's Kent McKenna. We're speaking to you here from Madera 95. We're here flying the Unlimited class and several other classes, but the biggie is the Unlimited. The airplane we're flying here is the Lancair 4. It's an airplane that we brought to the race originally in 93. It was the first year the airplane was legal to be raced. And there's been quite an evolution. The airplane, right off the bat, seemed like it was the fastest airplane you could possibly come up with. It's extremely slippery, and it doesn't take a lot to make the airplane go fast. And it flies extremely well. We've learned a lot in the last few years structure-wise. The first year we were here, the aircraft were flying around 180 miles an hour. Now we're up to over 210 miles an hour. So obviously we've had to learn to build the aircraft a lot more like full-scale aircraft. We have to do a lot more engineering. We can't build them like regular model airplanes anymore. We're experiencing up to 25 Gs in the turns. And the kill ratio has been kind of high at times, but we seem to be learning quite a few lessons from the past.
And five of these T6s jam around three, all racing for pylon one, getting very close together. Ken McSpadden was first out of the chute, but that changed rapidly around pylon one. Ken McSpadden again down on the deck in race two, the checker-cowled aircraft moving very nicely around pylon three. One, 2, 8, Leonard Wyatt up on top now, first to the pylon. Diego Lopez in that third place slot now, following Ken McSpadden around pylon three and almost overtaking him. Meanwhile, 1-2-8, Leonard Wyatt, the Hobbytown USA sponsored aircraft, is your leader still. Diego Lopez putting the heat earlier. He really needs to let the horsepower hang up to get back up into the action. Meanwhile, Gary Hover out on the course, feeling the pressure. Fred Bergdahl reeling him in. 0-3, Takahashi Kimura feels triple three. Dave Lizaway on his tail feathers. Dave sponsored by Race Pro Engineering.
Gary Hover lands untouched in 027, grounded after this impact. This heat became a real hotspot as the pilots and officials had words later.
711, Dave Miller, first around pylon number three. Now pulling around with 09, Mike Johnson, Ford, J. Reeve Pugli.
Dave Miller in race 7-1-1 leads the pack at the start of this heat late Saturday. Now this is a good lesson in airspeed, lift, and all that other stuff you've been told about flying radio-controlled aircraft. Saturday evening was the time for repairs, and the Nelson Pennzoil team had the ladies repairing landing gears as they collectively debriefed the day's results. Just like the big boys, this professional team really is the desired direction of this sport.
What actually happened?
All I did was I said blue pylon one, ready. He's coming on here and he's turning now. And boy, the light came on right then, and Gary went on around. And it really, each time I said blue pylon one now, blue pylon two now, and it worked great.
And that's after you identified.
Yeah,
one,
I said
taking off.
And sure. Each time he took off, I said pylon one. How do you read?
In other pits, as the sunlight fades away, repairs and tweaking for the big day ahead were well underway. Some of the smaller crews made the best of the situation and did the repairs under parking lot lights. Madera has its own form of gasoline alley, and you did repairs wherever you could as long as you had a flashlight. This is almost like being in the operating room. Let's cruise the early morning pits and check out the activity. Pilots and crews were stirring and anxious to get through the day and hopefully make it through the day. Those that make the grade in one piece will have an opportunity to race in the trophy dashes late Sunday afternoon. While the early birds were buying souvenirs, we cornered a real gentleman racer, Bill Cunningham, for a few words.
Hi, my name is Bill Cunningham, and I race for the A-Cubed Performance Engines race team. About 2 years ago, when we first got into giant scale air racing, we came out here with a single cylinder engine that was built by another person for us, and we did rather well for our first one. And after evaluating that, after we got back home, we decided we needed to get into making our own twin. And Bob Ayers and his brother Clark Ayers from Induction Systems, we all worked together, and they came up with what is now an A-Cubed line of engines. We have an 8.8 twin and a 4.4 single. The 4.4 is an excellent engine for running in the Formula One, and the twin is, what we run it in is for the unlimited class. Very smooth on the twin, and that's what we were looking for, is trying to get rid of the vibration. The engine is real small and it's light, and we've been able to set some record times with the engine without having to go to the very large cubic inch and heavy engines that a lot of other teams are using. We try to make use of the lighter engines for our airplanes. And we won the Galveston Air Races 2 years in a row now, and in 94 and 95. And now we're out here in Madera trying to do it again. So we'll see how things go at this race. We're experimenting with a new 11.4 cubic inch engine and going through a few growing pains with that engine, but I think we got that dialed out, and we're setting some really good times with that in a Vendetta. So we hope for good luck this year.
The wrap of the final heats begins early Sunday morning, and we highlighted the most aggressive and exciting portions of that racing for you. In this AT6 heat, race 075 aircraft piloted by Larry Young is chased closely by race 711 and 629.
On every turn. Down low is 629. 711 up above. Both aircraft approaching at the same time, right behind 075. Larry Young as they come around pylon number three. Now, 711 moving underneath the lead aircraft. 711, Dave Miller, sponsored by Royal Products and Aero Lettering. The two yellow T6s really well matched. Meanwhile, 075, Larry Young trying to stay out in front. Young now crossing the start line as he heads for pylon number one, opening up the gap a little bit. Seven-one-one now in the second place slot, being trailed by 6-2-9.
Larry Young, in his red and yellow trim T6, held the lead all the way in this heat.
David Wampler now, Bill Thomas Poole in the pace lane. Aircraft bunching up behind him. Gentlemen, you have a race. Bill Thomas pulling the little red pace plane off the course. Five of them banging around pylon three to the start at the center of the field, the checkered flag. First one to pylon number one is 669, Wes Daly. But he's got a battle on his hands as he heads for pylon three. Jim Maroney putting the challenge with 008 as both aircraft charge for pylon number one. Gentlemen, you do have a race. Drop the hammer as they bang around pylon three, four AT6s.
In this AT6 heat, watch the red and white race 03 from Japan, again piloted by Takahashi Kimura. Watch as he really dominates this heat.
Sangamido Hobby Shop out of Japan, your leader in 03 as he smokes the pylon three. Six-one-four with the orange cow. Very close. Herr Lechlin, the Chevron-powered aircraft, trying to keep that second-place slot, but things may change at pylon one. Meanwhile, on the back side of the chute for a Saturday morning cruise, Takahashi Kimura just smoking down the course, working low to the deck as he heads for pylon number one. And Mike Stokes in 3-5. Takahashi Kimura really pulling Herr Reichlin down on the deck.
Now watch the excitement and joy on Takahashi Kimura's face after this heat. The Formula One class had their shot at the course Sunday morning.
Here's a Formula One aircraft.
In the front of the pack at the start is race 118, Tom Easterday in the black and white Nemesis, badgered by Mike Hatfield in an old Tiger race 114 with the same color scheme. Both of these racers are from the famous Blues Brothers Racing Team.
Blues Brothers Racing Team, Mike Hatfield in old Tiger, the stubby winged aircraft, putting the challenge on him. The Blues Brothers occupying one and two. Frank Mill Jr. in the bronze racing team sponsored yellow Nemesis, though, moving himself up into the number two slot. Jerry Arsenal in that beautiful purple and silver Cosmic Wind, settling for fourth, at least at this time. And race 52, an alternate aircraft now trailing. Meanwhile, Easterday, 118 in the Michael Hatfield in old Tiger, first around the pin. Followed by race 68, Frank Knoll Jr., the yellow Nemesis. In the black and checkered Nemesis, 118 is Tom Easterday now, trying to pull tight on the inside of Frank Knoll. Frank Knoll, first time ever at radio-controlled air racing, but if you watch him fly during an in-time demonstration, you know that he can take on the task. Easterday got his hands full with Frank Knoll underneath him. Mike Hatfield, in the meantime, after a hard night of partying with the stubby wing old Tiger, is out in front. This is 697, all sponsored by himself, part of the Blues Brothers Racing Team out of Anaheim, California. Frank Knoll Jr. now capturing the lead with a valiant effort as he leads to pylon two and three in the Braun Racing Team, yellow Nemesis race 68. Now trails to pylon one, at least for this time. Frank Knoll Jr., race 68 in the yellow Nemesis, followed by Mike Hatfield. In 697, Tom Easterday in the black checkered Nemesis in race 118 in trail as they go around pylon three.
Frank Knoll cinched this Formula Heat with Mike Hatfield in second and Tom Easterday, after a great effort, will settle for third place, at least for now.
Jerry Arsenal now in the very pretty metallic purple and silver Formula One in a solid fourth place slot. Race 52, John Eaton now in fifth place. Bill Hempel Jr., number one, the yellow-winged red...
This Formula One heat also had some tight racing. Watch Bill Hempel Jr. in the red GR7 get the jump on the pack at the start.
Right behind him, and triple one. Rick Maida in the third place slot in the red and yellow Pennzoil-sponsored aircraft. Things are changing. Billy Hempel down on the deck. He knows there's pressure, and he's not about to budge. He wants to keep that first place slot. As now, Larry Sutherland starting to reel in 690 with race 90. And about to make his move on the backside into a slight headwind. Now, Larry Sutherland out pulls him to pylon 2 and 3. And jumps up in front of the pack. Sponsored by his wife. She's probably a pretty proud gal right about now. 690, though. Denny Baker wanting back his lead. Still applying pressure. Roles are reversed as they reply to 2 and 3, pylon. Larry Sutherland on that pass clocked at 123 miles per hour. And on this side, the yellow and green aircraft 40 is Jack Aycock in your last place. Now 690 really putting the heat on 90 on Larry Sutherland, and he gives it away at pylon 1 as Denny Baker now motors out in front.
Race 690, Denny Baker holds on to second place with Larry Sutherland in third place in race 90. Bill Hempel motored way out in front for his first win of the day.
90, Larry Sutherland trying to pick his way.
The heats are winding down. Time is short, only a few heats to go, and this is no time for your racer not to start. This was the last heat before the noon break Sunday, and the Unlimited class was taking their last shot before lunch. Brian Cowell leads the pack in the Discovery Channel Yellow Sea Fury, race 84.
And three, Carl Lindell in 65, and Frank Knoll in the yellow 68 of the Braun Racing Team. Lindell putting the moves on Frank Knoll as they approach pylon one. Way out in front, Brian Cowell in race 84, the Big Sea Fury. Sponsored by Discovery Channel, Classical Construction, and Aerospace Composites. Down on the deck now. Coming around pylon 3 now. This is your leader in the yellow Sea Fury, race 84, Brian Cowell. Now going underneath the last place aircraft. And rolling to the inverted.
The lunch break was the time to tune and repair for the pilots and crews. For the spectators, it was time to enjoy the radio-controlled air show, eat their favorite food, and tour the big vendor's tent and outside area.
Precision Aviation Design, this is a Bob Godfrey design aircraft. Weight is 34 pounds with a wingspan of 112 inches. Now, coming this direction, we'll put the aircraft in the maneuver called the very slow roll as he maintains altitude close to the runway, crossing through the show center and still executing the slow roll. You see those Ducati decals on the bottom. Go. Now, coming across from your right at show center, they'll be pulling the aircraft up into a big loop. At the top of the loop, a maneuver called the avalanche to get the bugs off the windshield. And triple avalanche completing the bottom of the loop. Notice the pilot is entering and exiting his maneuvers at the same altitude. Describing the first, pop the aircraft up on the wingtip, give you a picture of the cockpit. And two and three to see the underneath of the aircraft. And four, back to level flight. 5, 6, 7, 8. Bring it back over now to show you the cockpit. The rudder during this maneuver. Bill, relying on that 3W 120cc engine, and you need a reliable engine because if the engine should quit, you would have an extremely spectacular tail slide. Right into the impound area. Torquing the aircraft beautifully around, working that rudder very precisely. Ladies and gentlemen, Bill Hempel Jr., 30 feet off the deck.
Bill Hempel Jr.'s performance was only a sample of the entertainment during the noon break. With several heats to wrap up, it was back to racing right after that sandwich and a cold beer.
Arizona, obviously a very capable pilot.
Back to racing with a very, very tight AT6 race.
There's a jump on everyone, but that sure changed in a hurry. Aircraft 601, that's Martin Buchanan from Racers Haven Hobbies up in Bakersfield. Still pulling the lead around the turn. 133, the Frenchman, Alain Coppière, in the pink cowled white T6, pulling inside 601 Martin Buchanan on the back side of the chute. Look at this guy run. Where has he been all week? Now on this side, 133. Trepierre, your leader in the pink cowl as he hits pylon number one, followed by 601, Martin Buchanan, with aircraft. 133, Trepierre still holding off Buchanan in 601, but he pulls him just a little bit out of turn one, but on the backside he is reeled in by 133. These guys are really well matched, but that's the whole idea of limited AT6 racing. Now, lapping the last aircraft, which is 611, the young 18-year-old Ben McBride, after mixing it up with those big boys and the midair. Somebody did. Ben McBride went right through the middle. He's okay. 133, Alain Trepierre landing with his gear up out in the grass, and I think that might be 601. Martin can't wait to see the replay.
Ken McSpadden in race two went on to capture this heat, and we'll be right back to racing after a thank you for our sponsors. They are the folks that make it possible for us to promote events such as Madera.
And race 351. Don't really have any pilot information on 351. A mystery pilot.
As the sun gets lower in the sky, we are still finishing up final heats with this Formula One class.
Gentlemen, you do have a race. And 671 sweeping out in front of the pack, bending around pylon one. And the Duke Crow and the two Penzo aircraft, 111 and 111 and 117, very really precariously, almost sticking his tip into the dirt to avoid his teammate, but pulls it off and still leads the pylon one. Wow, what a pass. Had to be some wheels touching the canopy there. High up on top should be 111 with 117 underneath.
Babe Caltabiano in the Pennzoil race 117 takes the lead as we move right into the unlimited class as Bubba Spivey in the big green Sea Fury snatches the lead at the start.
As he approaches pylon one. Gentlemen, you have a race. Bubba Spivey, first one around with the big green Sea Fury 01, smoking the pylon one with Ken McSpadden in race number two. Carl Lindau, race 71, to Bob McClung, sponsored Stiletto, high up above. Now approaching three in the second place slot, followed by Ken McSpadden in race two. Race 87, John Crone, the big Sea Fury, now in the fourth place slot. But a battle between Ken McSpadden and Carl Lindau on the backside. Meanwhile, Bubba Spivey out for a Saturday afternoon cruise in the big Sea Fury 01. Bubba Spivey on that pass, 162 miles per hour. Meanwhile, on our side of the course, Bubba Spivey in the big green Sea Fury 01, now clearing pylon one and moving up on John Crone in the yellow race 87 Sea Fury.
And pow, as Ken McSpadden slams the dirt with some sort of failure or sun in his eyes, and here's the replay. Meanwhile, the Brian Nelson Pennzoil Racing Team was showing off their sponsor's Winston Cup race car, the support trailer, and their great race planes. What a team. And gentlemen, you have a race. Now as the sun gets lower, we finish up our next to last unlimited heat race.
'68X, Frank Knoll Jr., first one around the turn, actually 68. From the Braun Racing Team. Bill Hempel Jr. in race number one, the Hobby Barn Special sponsored. Right in the middle, and Bruce Brown, the Lancer, down on the deck in 15. Look at this young man go. Sponsored by Catawba Radios. And of course, he's controlling the aircraft with the Catawba radio. Really putting the heat on Frank Knoll. The young kid is taking on the elderly gentleman. And he smokes him down the chute. Oh boy, very close. Just wanted to make sure Frank knew he was there. Frank Knoll, though, very experienced pilot, piloting 68 skillfully around pylon number.
Rob Pastor managed to keep Frank Knoll and the Lancer behind him as we watch a nasty landing. Now for the last unlimited heat of the day, and what a race.
Frank Knoll, 680, first across the line in the Braun Racing Lancer. And he'd be smoking. Terry Kitchen in the big Bearcat down low on the deck. Pulling very tight on the inside, but 820, Ron Goodrich has got the Pond Racer running. Look at this guy go, and what a profile that airplane presents against the sky. Jerry Kitchen in race four, the Smirnoff Bearcat, sponsored by Bob McClung. He's in for the taste of victory. Jamie Pogley, though, in the Italic Green Lancer, does have one gear hanging, but he's not giving up as he smokes under 820 at pylon number three. This is the Mike Johnson Ford sponsored aircraft.
Jay Riplogley holds off Ron Goodrich in that sexy Pond Racer as we blast into the last biplane heat for the day.
Looks like 1-800 collect up high, pulling around first. But the pit special, Ken Thornton's still out there and fighting, but coming through the middle is 677. Ron Eisner in the Discovery Channel special. But he's been out snookered. Ken Thornton in 3.14, putting up quite a battle towards pylon number one. Thornton pulling hard, but look at 677. Ron Eisner right underneath. Thornton taking back the lead again as he rounds that pylon.
The low sunset really was tough on the pilots, and they would need intense concentration for the upcoming trophy dash, as it is fondly referred to, the dash for cash. And I needed those binoculars to see the aircraft as they passed through the sun. And Jim Goh Jr. from ISC sets up for his landing after he takes the win for the last heat of the day.
We need to put Supreme in here, but we're not sure whether we need Valvoline, Chevron,
or the battery.
Yeah, battery's good.
batteries. Can you get through the
furnace? George Steiner and his group were busy sorting out radio frequencies for the trophy dashes, while we were fortunate to get a few words from the Madera Airport manager, Sam Schneider.
Okay, I just want to say thank you from an airport supervisor's perspective to give me a chance to say thanks to all your airplane builders and airplane drivers for coming to Madera, to the Madera race. You're certainly welcome here. This is basically becoming our signature event at Madera. A couple of guys have said, hey, Sam, why do you let these people do this to your airport? And basically my answer is they're not doing it to our airport, they're doing it at our airport. You got 100% support from the entire city of Madera, the mayor, the city council, the whole nine yards. So thanks to the pilots. One thing, the folks who live right across the river here, about a couple of miles away, hear the angry bees early in the morning, so they're wondering why we start so early. They don't realize we got so many races, so many heats to run, a lot of things to get done. So it's good racing, keep it up, and be back next year.
The trophy matrices were up, and the pilots and crews were checking out their respective races. Last-minute repair work was well underway throughout the pit area, and every crew had a last-minute adjustment before their big race. And they were using the time wisely. Race time was close at hand, and you could feel the tenseness in the air and mostly watch how teamwork really makes a difference. By the way, I was handed this bribe by Chip Mull to announce his stitch scale covering and paint on Dave Von Lindsway's race plane. Works for me. Well, as you can see, we are ready to go racing. The sun is getting low in the sky, and the pilots wanted to get into the air. But first, a few words from Cal Orr, the race director.
And so the time penalties that you've acquired may not make any difference depending on the lead you have, or could make a significant difference.
In other words, you're going to time every airplane.
That's correct.
And then,
and if you guys don't cut, you'll make our job real easy.
Let's go race it.
And start your engine.
First trophy class up was the biplane class. Steve directs race 02 into the air. This is the week special of Wayne Boyles from Oakwood, Georgia. Next up is race 82, the night twister of Cliff Sands from Eagle Point, Oregon. Race 68, the yellow Christian Eagle of Ralph Bronze. Ralph is from Winnemac, Indiana, and he is airborne. Now, Steve flags race 88, the T-tail Mong racer of Kent McKenna's. Kent is from Lakewood, California. And the last biplane out is race 069, the black 1-800 collect Sean D. Tucker aircraft of Jim Goad, Jr. And Jim is from Indianapolis, Indiana, and that's Jim Sr. of ISC International helping his son into the air. And Murphy's Law catches Kent McKenna's Mong racer with an engine problem. Kent had fastest time in the biplane class, but unfortunately he would have to sit this one out.
Off the course. Jimmy Goad Jr. in the 1-800 Collect black biplane approaching pylon number one first. Leading everybody around the pack. High up above, Ralph Braun in 68. Now being overtaken by 82 Cliff Sands as he rounds pylon number three. And Cliff Sands working on the tail feathers of Jimmy Goad and says see as he heads to pylon number one. Up on the wingtip early, pulling hard on his elevator and slamming around pylon one. Jim Goad Jr. now coming down with a little bit of tailwind trying to recapture that position, but it looks like he will settle for second place as they come around pylon number three. Third place aircraft is Wayne Boyles in 02, the red, white, and blue weak solution Ralph Braun in 68 in trail. Now, Cliff Sands smoking around the course in race 82 with that John Eaton engine on board, sponsored by J&K Products. Cliff almost touch and go. Coming down the runway very low to the asphalt. Jim Goh Jr. doing a good job staying up there in the second position. Still your leader is Cliff Sands, race 82, in the Knight Twister little biplane, working very low to the deck, trying to keep Jimmy Goh back where he wants him in the number two slot. No question about it, Cliff Sands out.
Cliff Sands wins this trophy race with Jim Goh Jr. second, Wayne Boyles third, and Ralph Braun fourth. Next up is the limited AT6 class, beginning with the bronze class. The bronze class is the slower qualifies of the T6 aircraft. Cal is giving instructions on the trophy race and explaining that in this race, the two alternates will start with the first five aircraft. If one of these do not start, Steve will select the first alternate into the air to fill the class.
All seven start at once. Any questions? Watch the cuts.
Let's do it.
Steve directs at race 111, the Pennzoil T6 of Gary Corpies from Morgan Hill, California. Now, race 90. This is Larry Sutherland's T6. Larry is from Fresno, California. Race 91, the Chevron T6 is up and is flown by Ken Knowles from Lodi, California. Steve now waves at race 600, flown by Mac Douglas. Max is from Air Race Country, Reno, Nevada. The last aircraft up is race 295. The all-red T6 is flown by Walter McKee, all the way from Cedar Rapids, Iowa. Steve now gives the two alternates the cutoff sign, which signifies that all five aircraft are airborne and inside the two-minute launch window.
Gentlemen, you have a race. Base plane off the course. Larry Sutherland, sponsored by his wife, in 90, heading for pylon number one, that little hot dog out of Professor out of Fresno, California. Gary Corpy in triple one going very high, trying to take a shot at that front position. Sutherland holds him off. And Ken Knowles in 91 takes a shot, missing the wingtip narrowly. But Sutherland still 9-0. Losing his position to 91, Ken Knowles, as they round pylon number three. But look underneath at Gary Corpy, triple one, the Pennzoil Nelson-sponsored aircraft, in the lead for only a short time. But Larry Sutherland, working hard to get his position back, turns underneath triple one. And all of the aircraft are still intact after working that close around pylon number one. Now 91 and 90 coming down over the top of triple one again. All three aircraft arriving at the pylon very close together and at the same time. 108 miles an hour on that last pass for your lead aircraft. Ken Knowles in 91, the Race Pro Engineering aircraft. They have some of those kits for sale, by the way, at their booth. Now, Gary Corpy leading out of pylon one, but 91, Ken Knowles comes over the top of him every time, taking full advantage of coming out high and diving with the tailwind in his favor. Both 90 and 91 now go around triple one. Triple one back in the fray in this number two slot on the back side of the chute. Mac Douglas in 600 now. being lapped by all of
Ken Knowles in race 9-1 takes the first place slot, followed by Gary Corpy, race 111 in second place. Larry Sutherland, race 90, takes third. Walter McKee, race 295, fourth. And Mac Douglas, race 600 in fifth place.
Thanks.
More T6s as the second fastest qualifiers head for the starting grid. This will be the silver T6 trophy race. Engines are running and Steve directs out the first aircraft. And this is race 008. Jim Maroney with JMD Racing from Hanford, California. Next out is race 091, Carl Almendinger's Aerosport T6. Carl is from Santa Clara, California. Steve checking that the pilot is in the box and ready to take command of his aircraft as he directs race 128 into the air. This is Leonard Wyatt from Fresno, California, which is just 17 miles south of Madera. The third T6 cleared to take off is race 2, Ken McSpadden of the Bad Moon Racing Team from Pomona, California. Now, the last aircraft in this silver T6 class is race 94 with the Blues Brothers Racing Team, Diego Lopez from Corona, California. And no alternates will be used as we drop the hammer.
Diego Lopez himself, sponsored by Zap Adhesives, Fataba Radios, and Byron Originals. Gentlemen, you have a race. And 008. Jim Maroney first out of the chute as he approaches pylon number one, leading the pack around the pylon. Down low on the deck, Ken McSpadden in race two, putting on the charge. But Diego Lopez from the Blues Brothers up high at 94, going over the top of McSpadden, but down low, 091. The hot rodder himself, Carl Almendinger, pulls everyone to pylon number one, putting himself into the second place slot, followed by Diego Lopez, race 94, Ken McSpadden in race two, and 128, Leonard Wyatt. Still 008, Jim Maroney, your leader. Carl Almendinger wanting to wind him in, moving down fast on the backside of the straightaway with that tailwind to his advantage. Diego Lopez embedded in the third place slot. Back on the fourth and fifth place, things are changing as Ken McSpadden moves down underneath 128. Jim Maroney still smoking around the course.
Jim Maroney's race 008 sweeps first as Carl Almendinger, race 091, takes second. Ken McSpadden, race 2 for third. Leonard Wyatt, race 128, fourth. And Diego Lopez's race 94 in fifth place. The gold T6 class, the fastest qualifiers of that class with race 333, Dave Von Lindsway from Sutter Creek, first into the air. Race 01, Bubba Spivey from Oakwood, Georgia, now up. Steve now directing race 164, Sean Everson. Sean is from Santa Clara, California. The third T6 out is race 03, Takahashi Kimura from Kanagawa, Japan. And the first alternate to replace 314, a no start, is Archie Snyder's race 191 from Atherton, California.
Okay, 191, Archie Snyder, sponsored by Aerosport, alternate aircraft up in the fray as 3.14 was not able to make it into the air. And gentlemen, you have a race. Triple three, Dave Von Lindsway, first out of the chute. And Bubba Spivey in 01, Moving up into the second place slot, putting the heat on 333, Dave Von Linsaway, sponsored by Race Pro Engineering, painted with Stitz paint. They paint you with the Chip Mo has over there in his booth in the vendor area. This is a Race Pro Engineering aircraft, by the way. Now, Dave Von Linsaway, 333 on this side of the chute. Your leader as he moves out. Clocked at 106, 113 miles per hour. Now, Bubba Spivey in the Dayglow Orange Cow, really trying to reel in Dave Von Linsaway as they approach pylon one. Your alternate aircraft, 091 Archie Schneider from Aerosport, moving up into the third place slot. I believe, is Sean Everson in the fourth place slot. And I don't know where Takahashi Kimura is. I think he went up high, probably with a problem. Archie Schneider still in that third place slot in 191. And Bubba Spivey will have to settle for second.
And Bubba Spivey manages to get around Dave Von Linsaway and takes the first place slot. We had a problem seeing these aircraft, so my hat's off to these pilots. They are doing a fantastic job of racing in these conditions.
And the first place slot, 01, Bubba Spivey, sponsored by Robart Manufacturing.
Bubba Spivey grabs first place by the skin of his teeth in the gold T6 trophy race.
From the Putz Boys racing team.
And now for the toughest race to follow, the Silver Class Formula Ones with five planes from the Blues Brothers Racing Team. Four of these aircraft are all of the same color scheme, black and white with checkered patterns, and this should be real interesting.
And this is where the fun begins.
Start them up!
Steve gives the command, start them up, and seven Formula Ones crank up. The first of the Blues Brothers is up. The only different paint scheme. This is Jerry Arsenal with race 877, and this is his first Madera air race. The next up is race 3.14 in the Blues Brothers colors is Ken Thornton in his old Tiger from Anaheim, California. Next up is the Nemesis, race 118 of Tom Easterday's from Brea, California. Now Diego Lopez with a Nemesis also, race 94. From Corona, California. And others, Rolly Old Tiger, race 6-9, Michael Hatfield from Mesa, Arizona, and all five scheduled aircraft make it into the air.
And gentlemen, you do have a race. Tom Easterday in the black and white Nemesis, first down on the pin, followed by 3.14, Ken Thornton on the backside. Things are already changing. Tom Easterday still holding on to his lead with race 94, Diego Lopez in the second Nemesis, right on his tail. Thank you. Ken Thornton in 3.14 in the old Tiger in your third place slot as they come around pylon 3. 118 still. Tom Easterday moving down the course nicely. Tom at 128 miles per hour on that pass. Now, 3.14, Ken Thornton out pulls Diego Lopez in race 94 and moves into the second place slot as he hits pylon 3. In the back of the pack, in the fourth position, Jerry Arsenal, Michael Hatfield, 697, trailing in the fifth place slot. Still your leader, really cranking around the course, is Tom Easterday, his last pass at 129 miles per hour. Now, this is Tom Easterday, your leader, on our side of the course, heading for pylon number one in the black and white Blues Brothers Nemesis, followed by Ken Thornton in 3.14. What a number. No wonder they call him Elwood. Now, Jerry Arsenal moving under Diego Lopez in 94. Diego moving high on the course. Engine not at full power. Putting Jerry Arsenal up into the third place slot. And Michael Hatfield moving up into 697 into the fourth place slot. Tom Easterday up over the top of 697, putting Mike Hatfield a lap down.
Race 118, the black and white checkered nemesis of Tom Easterday sweeps the silver Formula One class for first place. The gold Formula One's next up, the fastest qualifiers of that class. This class has two unusual aircraft, the low-winged GR7s, and we'll point them out as they launch.
Coming by.
First out and anxious to get airborne is race 723, one of those pretty GR7s. This one is piloted by Bill Knudsen from Ramona, California. This is the lone nemesis in this class, race 671, piloted by Ken McBride from San Jose, California. Now, the colorful GR7 of John Crones, race 88, from Whittier, California. John is with the laid-back racing team. The Pennzoil sponsored race 111, Cosmic Wind, flown by Rick Maida from San Jose, California. Rick is with the Nelson racing team. This is a Little Tony, race 702. That's that smaller than legal number on the tail, flown by Fred Weaver from San Jose, California. And that's all five aircraft for the gold Formula One Trophy Dash.
Gentlemen, you have a race. All the aircraft now down on the course. John Crone in race 88, the GR7, first out of the chute. But following him in hot pursuit is 671, just sweeping him around pylon one. 671 piloted by Ken McBride. Sponsored by Chevy Parts from San Jose, California. Now, Ken McBride and 671. This aircraft built by Bob and Ken McBride. First around pylon one, followed by John Crone in race 88, the Lime and Rose GR7. Down low on the deck in the yellow and red Pennzoil, Cosmic Wind, Rick Maida. In the third place slot, now at center field. The leader still 723, Bill Knudsen, by the way, in GR7, with 671, the white nemesis. Ken McBride in hot pursuit with 111, Rick Maida following around in the third place. Well, it was in the third place slot. Now in the fourth as John Crone in race 88, the Lyman Green GR7 finally captures back the third place slot. Now moving up on 671 as they approach pylon number three. Fred Weaver in 702 out on the course somewhere. 723, Bill Knutson, still motoring around the course in front of the pack. But he is getting major heat from 671, Ken McBride, and it finishes with...
It was hard to tell in the fading sunlight, but John Crone in race 88 took the first place honors in his GR7. There were a few in front of John, but apparently with cut penalties, John ran a clean race and was awarded first place.
Also watch start cuts. 10-second penalty, or if you're as far out as pylon 2, you'll be fifth place regardless of the outcome of the race. Alternates, we don't have any. Let's go flying.
Now it's time for the unlimited hot rods, beginning with the slowest qualifiers, the bronze class. The first aircraft out is race 02, Wayne Boyles from Oakwood, Georgia. Next, Wayne's teammate, Bubba Spivey, Sea Fury, race 01, also from Oakwood, Georgia. John Crone up again, this time with his Sea Fury, race 87. Race 177, also a Sea Fury, piloted by David Hendon from Tulsa, Oklahoma, and David will not make the bronze trophy dash. Last up is race 187, Ken Trainer, with the only P39 entered. Ken is from Chula Vista, California.
Somewhere up high, or somewhere, 87, Bubba Spivey, the 01 is out of the business. Wayne Boyles in race 02 from Oakwood, Georgia, takes the first in the unlimited bronze class. Next up is the silver unlimited. These are the second fastest qualifiers of the hot rods.
If there are no cuts, you keep our job real simple. The cut penalties will be the same as they've been all week. And we'll also watch the start cuts. A blatant start cut, which is down by pylon 2, you'll be in fifth position regardless of the outcome of the race. With the alternates, we'll fire up all seven of you. If one of you flames out during the starting procedure, we'll then take one of the alternates. Any questions? Watch the cuts. Let's go fly.
Gentlemen, start your engines.
This is the unlimited silver trophy race, and they are anxious to race as seven hot rods fire up. Steve Parola now directs the first aircraft. This is Bill Hempel Jr.'s Hobby Barn sponsored race one. Bill is from Tucson, Arizona. Next out is J.R. Wilbur's race 911. J.R. was plagued with problems earlier, and it appears the problems are still around as J.R. is forced to pull out with mechanical problems. Next out is Bruce Brown with race 15, the Lancer. Young Bruce is from San Diego, California. Now for a twin, the Incredible Pond Racer. This is race 820 and piloted by Ron Goodrich with the Braun Racing Team. Ron is from Winnemac, Indiana. This is race 680, the Yellow Lancer, piloted by Frank Knoll Jr. Frank is from Dayton, Ohio, also with the Braun Racing Team. Another Lancer, this is race 9 with J. Rip Logley, piloting for Mike Johnson Ford. J is from Lancaster, California. Race 9 replacing J.R. Wilbur's 911 as he pulls back and the alternate fills his slot. Now, let's go racing. The hammer is down, and here
gentlemen,
we go.
Gentlemen, you have a race. Pace plane off the course. First one down, Bill Hempel Jr. making the move at pylon number one and moving out briskly to avoid hot pursuit right on his tail. Right on his tail is, should be 680, Frank Knoll. Bill Hempel in the second place slot is 680 in the Yellow Lancer from the Braun Racing Team. Frank Knoll Jr. driving out in front. His last pass at 158 miles per hour. J.B. Pogley in race 9, the metallic green Lancer, out in the number 3 slot. Meanwhile, Bill Hempel pulls underneath Frank Knoll Jr., trying to get his lead back, beating him to the pylon, but Frank is right on his tail feathers on the backside of the chute.
Bill Hempel Jr. in race 1 sweeps first place as Frank Knoll Jr. in race 680 takes second. J. Rip Logley, third. Bruce Brown in race 15 for fourth, and fifth going to Ron Goodrich in race 820, the Pond Racer.
Bill Hempel,
and here is the winner,
Frank
Bill Hempel Jr.
Crossing just barely in front of Bill Hempel in race 1.
A blatant start cut over pylon 2 at the horn will cost you fifth position regardless of the outcome of the race. The alternate, if one if you are unable to get going during the launch procedure, will take the alternate in your spot.
What time will that alternate be taking off at the 2-minute? Let's say we break a prop on takeoff.
No,
we have
during,
time.
Come
do
on,
we have time to change
a break.
It?
No. During the launch procedure.
Huh? I mean, if it's in that 2-minute window.
You grind up a prop, that's it. Yeehaw, yeehaw!
Be careful.
This is the gold trophy race, the fastest qualifiers of the unlimited class, and the last dash for cash today. Steve gives the word, and here we go. First out is race 126, the young Rob Pastor from Susanville, California. Next up is race 68X, Don Albright in the Yellow Lancer. Don is from Winnemac, Indiana, and is with the Bronze Racing Team. Dave Von Linsaway up now with race 886, another Lancer. Dave is from Choctaw, Oklahoma, and is racing with the AQ Racing Team. Next to the line, race 007, Rusty Van Baron from Hanford, California. Rusty is with the colorful Pennzoil Nelson Racing Team. Another twin, the big P38, race 125 with Dennis Crooks and crew trying desperately to get both of those Huskies running together. And it looks like a no-go as the first alternate is called out to replace the P38. This is race 00, piloted by Dave Smith from Arizona. And here we go for the fastest race of the day, and look at that sunlight.
Gentlemen, you have a race. And here we go, and as suspected, Don Albright and Rob Pastor, 126, down on the deck. Rob Pastor pulls Albright around pylon number one, and this kid is going to pull him right down on the asphalt to try to regain that quiet air. Albright, though, on top of his canopy, goes up over the top. Don Albright now in the lead as they fly around. 888 right in the middle. 886, I'm sorry, David Von Linsaway with Rob Pastor, 126 now in the third place slot. Look at Albright rocket around the course. The seasoned racer is not going to let these young kids have any part of his tail feathers. Now, David Von Linsaway, AQ Performance Engine 886, pulling underneath Albright, really putting on the pressure. That last pass of Don Albright's at 193 miles per hour. 193. Yippee-i-o. Don Albright, still your leader. And 886, David Von Linsaway, right on his tail feathers with Rob Pastor in the third place slot. Dave Smith, 00, moved up into the fourth place slot. Actually, that is 007, Rusty Van Baron in the fourth place slot with the 280cc Herb Branson engine on board.
What a race with Don Albright in race 68X taking first, Dave Von Linsaway's race 886 second, Rob Pastor race 126 third, Rusty Van Baron's race 007 fourth, and bringing up fifth is Dave Smith in race 00. What a race, and here is the fastest guy of the day, Don Albright, your unlimited gold winner. Another Madera comes to a close and another week of exciting racing. Madera will be back next year for the sixth annual. Same place, Madera, California, the home of radio-controlled air racing. We will see you then.